This is the AP Calculus mid-fourth 6 weeks exam, 2018 version. We had this test earlier this week in calculus, and this is kind of a comprehensive test of where we've gone so far in the school year, mostly first semester. This is pre-integral calculus, derivative calculus. So we have 17 multiple choice problems and one free response problem. And here's the first multiple choice problem. What is the limit as x approaches infinity of 2x squared plus 3x minus 8x to the fourth power over 3x to the fourth power minus 2x squared? What this is looking for what the horizontal asymptote would be, the equation of the horizontal asymptote. So the answer choice would be like horizontal asymptote would be y equals 2, y equals negative 8/3, y equals negative 2/3, and so on. And what you can do is look for the largest powered exponent. Okay, so we have up here negative 8x to the fourth power, and down in the denominator, 3x to the fourth power. So the simplification of these two highest powered exponents, the denominator and numerator, and numerator over the denominator, you have minus 8x to the fourth over 3x to the fourth. And what happens is x to the fourth over x to the fourth cancel each other, and we're left with negative 8/3. And the rationale behind this is that relative to these highest powered terms in the numerator and denominator, the lower powered terms are inconsequential as we approach infinity. Therefore, our correct answer would be negative 8/3, which is answer choice B. Next, problem two, the function g given by g of x equals negative 16x squared plus 128x plus 23 for x is greater than or equal to 0 is, and we have different choices here, and so to find increasing, decreasing, if we take the first derivative, we are well on our way. So the first derivative of this function, g prime of x, is going to be equal to 2 times negative 16, so we have negative 32 x, and then the derivative of 128x is 128. And then if we set the first derivative equal to 0, we can tell that'll get us along the way, and we can factor out here. I think we can factor out negative 32. Our maybe an easier way to do this would be just to add negative 32 to both sides of the equation. So if we have 32x equals 128, and we divide by 32, we get x equals, put 3x divided by 32. 128 divided by 32 is 4. So 4 is what we call our critical number. Okay. And our critical number we can place on a number line here below. And we'll put F, I said F, I meant G prime. Sometimes the letters G or F will be used. And then if we find a number on either side of this critical number 4, where the first derivative is equal to 0, we can do some analysis and pick a number less than 4. We can pick 0. So if we plug in 0, we are going to get positive 128. So our function is going to be increasing from 0 to 4. And then we pick a number bigger than 4, say 5, we would have we just have to analyze either side of the critical number. We know what's going on. So are we decreasing from 0 to 4? No, we are not. Are we increasing from 0 to 4? That looks promising. Are we decreasing from 0 to 8? Well, 8 is really not a relevant situation here. Our answer choice for this one is B. Next three, for the equation y equals x minus 1 over 3x plus 2, what is the slope tangent line of the graph equation where x equals 1? We can use for this the quotient rule of calculus, where we have a high in the numerator and a low in the denominator. So our high is going to be equal to x minus 1 . Our derivative of our high, which we also need to be aware of, is equal to 1. Our low is equal to 3x plus 2. And our derivative of our low is going to be equal to 3. So our y prime is going to be equal to low d high minus high d low. And the low is 3x plus 2. And the derivative, that's low d high, derivative of high is 1, minus high, high is x minus 1, d low is 3, all over low squared. So here we have 3x plus 2, there's a song that I'll sing in class. Lodi, 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 high, minus high, high, all over low squared. Let's start. Anyway, we can simplify and distribute. We have the numerator 3x plus 2, and now this other one's a little trickier. We're going to have minus 3x. And then we're going to have plus 3, because we have minus minus 3 times 1, right? So plus 3. And that's going to be all over this 3x plus 2, 23x plus 2 squared. And we have cancellation 3x minus 3x. And then we have in the numerator 2 plus 3 is 5. And in the denominator, we have quantity 3x plus 2 squared. And now we can say, if we plug in for x equals 1, we'll say y prime sub 1. We have still the numerator 5. And we have the denominator 3 times 1 plus 2 squared, which is going to be equal to 5 over, in the denominator, 5 squared, so 5 over 25, which simplifies to 1/5. And so our correct answer is D. Next, problem 4. Given the function fx equals x cubed minus 3x squared, find all values for x for which the graph of f of x is concave up. And there are some good things going on here. I want to show a little sketch that I put off my classes for the function f. We have plus, minus, increasing, decreasing, and then concave up, concave down. Below that, we're going to put f prime. And for f prime, we put plus or minus below the increasing decreasing sign. And increasing decreasing. And then finally, the f double prime, which is the second derivative, we just put plus minus here. So you can kind of see the relationship between the second derivative being plus or minus and increasing and decreasing in f prime and concave up and concave down original function f. So f prime of x is our first derivative of this, which we get 3x squared, and we'll have minus 4x. And then we need to take our second derivative. So we'll just derive this again. We have 2 times 3, which is 6x, and we have negative minus 4. We set this equal to 0. 0 equals 6x minus 4. So 4 is equal to 6x, and dividing by 6, we have x is equal to 4 sixths or 2/3. So that's going to be our critical number with relationship to what's going on. Based on that, we can already eliminate, I believe, answer choices B and C. That's not going to matter. So anyway, we'll put in 2/3. And we can pick a number over here, less than 2/3, maybe, I don't know, 0. Well, 0, we'll put f double prime, f down below. If we plug in 0 here, we'll have negative 4, so we're going to be concave down on this interval. And if we pick in a number bigger than 2/3, say 1, we'll have 6 minus 4 or 2 positive. So we have concave up on this. And then if we, that's going to be answer choice A. And if we go ahead over here and look at our plus and minus, we see that concave up on that up U is related to that plus sign down below in the F double prime row. So let's go on to problem number 5. Given function g of x equals x cubed minus 6x squared, the graph of g of x has a relative minimum and x equals. Well, if we just say, okay, g prime is going to be equal to 3x squared minus 12x. That look right? And we can set this equal to 0. So 0 equals, and we can factor out a 3x from each term. So we have 3x times quantity x minus 4. And then our critical numbers based on this are going to be x equals 0 and also x equals 4. So your only candidates for relative minimum are going to be 0 or 4. So already we can take away A and B. Now let's just do some analysis here. Our number line, we put 0, 4. And we'll put F. Again, I want to put f g prime up above and g down below. And for less than 0, if we take, say, negative 1, we'll have a negative times a negative, which will be positive. So we're going to be increasing here. That's going to be, so this 0 is not looking good for a relative minimum, right? You're going up to that point. And next, between 0 and 4, say 1, we'll have a positive times a negative. Okay, we have found, have we not, a relative maximum at x equals 0. And if we pick a number bigger than 4, say 5, we'll have positive times a positive. We're going to go up our relative minimum. Oops. What did I say? I crossed out the wrong one, didn't I? Because I should have crossed out this negative 4. See, it's just like if you do the right analysis, you could even mess up a little bit and still correct yourself. So that's where our relative minimum is located, at x equals 4. I think on the version of the test I gave to my students, I think I didn't give the correct answers. So this is a corrected version of that. test. 6, if f of x equals 2x squared plus 3x plus 1, what is the equation of the line tangent to the graph of f of x where x equals 2? Well, I tell my students to find a tangent line, we need two things. We need a point, and we need a slope. In this case, for the point, we know that our x-coordinate value is 2. We need to find a y-coordinate. So if we want to find a y-coordinate, we just go ahead and put f of 2 and just plug in for x. So we have 2 times 2 squared plus 3 times 2 plus 1. And that simplifies to 2 times 2 squared, I think that's 8, plus 6 plus 1. What is that looking like? 15. So our point we have is 2 comma 15. Next, we need to find our slope. Before that, we're going to take our first derivative here, and f prime of x is going to be equal to 4x plus 3. And if we want to go ahead and f prime of 2, find our slope at that point, we'll have 4 times 2 plus 3, which equals 11. So that's going to be equal our m, what I call m sub t. So we have m sub t is equal to 11. Now we can go ahead and use our point slope form, which I'm going to do down here below in purple. So I'll put y minus y1, which is 15, equals m times x minus x1. So we have y, I just put m, didn't I? I need to put the number for m, which is 11. There we go. So y minus 15 equals 11x minus 22. And if we add 15 to both sides, this equation solve for y, we're going to get y equals 11x minus 7, which is our answer choice C. Okay, and that's number 6. Number 7, the absolute maximum of the function fx equals x cubed minus 4x squared over the interval 0 to 5, closed interval, occurs where x equals, and we have these choices. Well, obviously, we can't eliminate any of these choices because they are all, we have the two endpoints here at 0 and 5, and we can't eliminate any of these other two yet. So I'm going to go ahead and make a little table over here at the right, which is what I call my candidate test. And what are the candidates? Well, we have, our candidates are going to be our endpoints, 0 and 5, first of all. And we can already find f of 0 because f of 0 is going to be, we just plug in 0 to this function here, and we're going to get 0. Okay. And we can find f of 5, and that's going to be 5 cubed minus 4 times 5 squared, which is going to be 125 minus 100. So f of 5, we can say, is equal to 25. So now we know that we're looking for absolute maximum. We know that it cannot be answer choice A, right? That's a little lower. So let's go on and see if we can find a critical number to find an additional candidate. Well, to do that, we're going to say f prime of x is equal to 3x squared minus 8x. And if we factor out an x and set that equal to 0, we have 0 equals x times quantity 3, x minus 8. And so we could have x equals 0 or 3x minus 8 is equal to 0. And then if we add 8 to both sides, we'll have 3x equals 8. And so x equals 8/3. So 8/3 is our critical number. And what does that do for us? Well, we're pretty sure that B can't be a correct answer either. So now we're between two of them. It's choices C and D. And all we have to do is plug in 8/3 to this thing here. And it might even be a little easier than that if we make a little table and put 8/3 here. And I'll show why in a second. If we put f prime up here and f down below, what's a number less than 8/3? Well, maybe 0, but 0 wouldn't be a good one because that would make this whole thing 0, and we already know that. What if we pick 1? Well, we would have positive, and 3 times 1, when I say a positive times a negative, so we'll have a negative here. So that means we'll be going down. And then to the right of 8/3, say 3, we would have positive times a positive. So we know that 8/3 is not a candidate since it's going to be at a relative minimum. So that means our absolute maximum in this interval has to be 25, and that absolute maximum absolutely occurs at answer choice D. Next, 8. The graph below is of the function f of x. At what point is f of x greater than 0, f prime of x greater than 0, and f double prime of x less than 0? And again, it's this one thing that I drew before earlier, right? F, you have plus minus, increasing, decreasing, and concave up, concave down, and then we have the f prime row. We have plus minus under the increasing, decreasing, and increasing, decreasing here. And then the f double prime, we have plus or minus under the increasing, decreasing. And so what we're looking for is in f of x being greater than 0, you would have to have the value of this function be above the x-axis. So this point down here, C, is not going to work for us at all. So we're going to be able to eliminate that. Next, says f prime of x is greater than 0. Well, f prime of x is greater than 0 where the slope is positive. And we can see the slope is positive up here at A and also at D. But that slope is negative, the slope of that tangent line is negative at B. So B is eliminated as a potential right answer. And now we want for f double prime greater than 0, where f double prime is greater than 0, where, see, there it is. And what happens there? Where we're concave up. So we look for that up U-shape thing, and that does not occur at A, it occurs at D. We have apparent concavity, upward concavity, concave up. So D is our correct answer. Okay, next. If g of x equals 2 times 28x, what is g prime of 2? For this, we're going to take the first derivative. That's all we're looking for here. So g of x is going to be equal to 2 times 8x to the power of 1/2. And taking that first derivative here, the derivative of g prime of x is going to be equal to 2 times, we have 8x. Before I do that, g prime of x is equal to 2, and then we multiply by this power. So we'll have 2 times 1 half, and then we'll have 8x. We take that 1 half and subtract 1, so we'll have 8x to the negative 1 half times the derivative using the chain rule of the inside, which is 8. So just simplifying what we can, we have 2 times 1 half will just cancel each other. And rewriting this, we would have g prime of x is equal to, we still have this a sitting up here in the numerator, so that's 8 over, we have 8x to the negative 1 half power. We're just going to put 8x down here. And do we have anything else in here? Is that all there is to it? I think so. So what can we do now? We can just substitute in. So we'll say g prime of 2 is equal to 8 over the square root of 8 times 2, which is 8 over square root of 16, or 8 over 4, which simplifies to 2. So that is our correct answer, C. Next, 10. If f of x equals x to the fourth power minus 24x squared, what are all the points of inflection in the function f of x? And what we have here is, well, let's just start one. We need to get the second derivative. Well, before we do that, I'm going to do this thing we did before, right? F, we have plus, minus, increasing, decreasing. Concave up, concave down. The F prime row, we have plus or minus under the increasing, decreasing. And we have increasing, decreasing here. And then the F double prime row, we have plus or minus. Plus or minus. So what we're looking for in the points of inflection are where F double prime changes from positive to negative, or from negative to positive. So that would be our justification in advance. Well, our first derivative is going to be F prime is going to be equal to 4x cubed minus 48x. And our second derivative, F double prime, is going to be equal to 12x squared minus 48. And we can set this equal to 0 by factoring out of 12. So we factor out 12, we get 20x squared minus 4. And that's going to simplify to 12 times 20x plus 2, x minus 2. So that gives us only two possible points of inflection. Okay? And we're going to have x equals negative 2 and x equals 2. And these are only possible points of inflection. Okay, so anything with a 0 in it, we know cannot be correct, right? And all three of these have zeros in them. So our correct answer is going to be A. And if we wanted to, we could go do a further analysis of that to find where they are, right? Negative 2, 2, F double prime, F down below, and we'd see, well, it doesn't matter what they are, we know those have to be the points, so we'll just kind of leave it there. 11. If y equals 4 sine 20x over 2, what is d squared y over dx squared? That's really another way of asking for the second derivative. And one thing I've done is I've taught my calculus students this little nifty thing called snow cone Santa Claus. When you take a derivative, if you go down like this, the derivative of sine is cosine, the derivative of cosine is negative sine. Derivative of negative sine is negative cosine. The derivative of negative cosine equals to sine. And for integration, it goes the opposite direction. So the integration of sine is cosine, right? For cosine, and the derivative, I said, the derivative of sine is cosine. The derivative of cosine is negative sine. So we have to have a negative sign somewhere in the answer here, and so that's going to take out these two guys right here. So now let's just go through this. Y prime is equal to 4 cosine of x over 2 times the derivative of the inside here, which is going to be 1/2. So simplifying, y prime is going to be equal to 2 cosine quantity x over 2. And if we take our second derivative, y double prime is going to be equal to, we'll have a negative 2 sine, we'll have x over 2 times the derivative of that inside, which is x over 2, 1/2. That's going to simplify to negative sine 40x over 2. So that's going to give us answer choice C. Okay, let's go on to problem 12. The graph of g prime of x shown below, where are the critical points located on the graph of g of x? Well, the critical points are going to be where either g, where are critical numbers, where g prime of x is equal to 0 or undefined. And this is the graph of g prime of x. So we see we have one of these at 0, looks like about 2, looks like this is about 3 or something like that. So 0, 2, and 3. Where we see that? Answer choice A. Next, 13. The altitude of projectile at feet is given by the function g of x equals negative 16x squared plus 128x plus 10 on the interval. Close interval from 0 to 10, what is the projectile's maximum elevation? So this is another absolute value theorem problem. We had one earlier. And what we can do here is, again, we have a candidate test, don't we? Our maximum elevation is going to be, well, we'll have x, g of x. We know our endpoints have to be candidates, so 0 and 10 would have to be candidates. And then g prime of x is going to be equal to our first derivative, which could be negative 32 x plus 128. And then if we set this equal to 0, this looks familiar, doesn't it, to another problem we did earlier. So we have 128 equals 32x, and then dividing both sides by 32, we have x is equal to 4. So that's going to be another candidate here. And so we can just plug in and see what we get. Well, if we plug in 0 to this first one, we're going to get an elevation of 10. If we plug in 4, we're going to get g of 4 is going to be negative 16 times 4 squared plus 128 times 4 plus 10. And then 4 squared is 16, and then 16 times negative 16, we're going to have negative 256. And then 128 times 4 is going to be, let's see, 128 times 2 is 256. Well, times 4 is going to be plus 512 plus 10 That simplifies 2, 256 plus 10, or 266. So 266 would be a candidate. Okay. Well, we know that's going to be the maximum elevation because that's our maximum answer choice, right? So we know D is our correct answer, and that saves us from having to put in 10 and figuring all that out. Another thing we could do is we could go ahead and at 4 and do the analysis, and we'd realize that we would have a relative maximum at x equals 4. Next, 14. On the interval, the closed interval from negative 1 to 4, what is the average rate of change for the function fx equals x squared plus 2 times 20, 2 times square root of 20, x plus 5? Well, we just need to find f of negative 1, and that's going to be negative 1 squared plus 2 times square root of negative 1 plus 5. So that's going to be 1 plus 2 times square root of 4, which is 2. That's going to be 5. And then we're going to find f of 5. And for that, we get 5 squared plus 2 times f square root of. Oh, I put, let me find 4. I don't know why I'm putting 5 in there. Yeah, 4 squared. So we have 2 times square root of quantity. We have 4 plus 5. That's going to make more sense. So for that, we're going to have 16. That's 4 squared. And I put f of 5 here. I'm going to put f of 4. Why do I have 5 on the brain? I don't know why. That's going to be f of 4 is equal to that. Okay, here we go. So we get 16. And then we have 2 times square root of 9, which is 3. So we'll have 16 plus 6, right? Which equals 22. So for that, we're going to get our average rate of change equals f of b minus f of a over b minus a. And in this instance, we're going to get f of b is 22 minus f of a, which is 5, over 4 minus negative 1, which is going to be 17 over 5. Well, 17 over 5, what is that going to simplify to? I think that's going to be 3.4. Is that right? 17 over 5 is going to be equal to, yeah, 3.4. So that is our answer choice B for number 14. Next, 15. The graph of y equals g of x in closed interval from 0 to 5 has endpoints at 0 comma 0 and 15 comma 5. If g of x is continuous in closed interval 0 to 5 and differentiable in the open interval 0 to 5, there exists an x value c such that this is what's called the mean value theorem, where if you have these conditions, you'll have there is a value of c where IROC, our instantaneous rate of change, equals our average rate of change. So all we need to do is just find our average rate of change. Okay, just like the previous problem, we have f of b minus f of a over b minus a. And for that, we get, let's see, f of F of B is 5, right? F of A is 0 over B minus A. Well, it's going to be 15 minus 0. So we're going to get 5 fifteenths, which simplifies to 1/3. So what is our correct answer here? G prime of C is equal to 1/3. Okay. A lot of students had problems with trouble with this one for some reason. It seems like an easy problem. Okay, 16. If h of x equals x cosine x, what is h prime of pi over 2? I hope you can realize that this is a product of two functions, and for that I have this little graphical organizing box, which is set up like this. What's happening to my writing here late in the day? We can go with it. Okay, we have x, and what is the derivative of x? 1. And we have our other function. It's cosine x. And what's the derivative of cosine x? Supposed to be negative sine x. And so h prime of x is going to be cosine x times 1, which will be just cosine x, plus, so we're going to have negative x sine x, so we'll have minus x sine x. Well, now we'll find h prime of pi over 2. Well, the cosine of pi over 2, that's going to be the top of the unit circle, is going to be equal to 0. And the sine of pi over 2 is going to be equal to 1. So now we can just say, okay, cosine of Let's say cosine of pi over 2 minus pi over 2 times sine of pi over 2. Well, cosine pi over 2 is equal to 0, and well, minus pi over 2 and sine of pi over 2 is 1, so we're going to simplify to negative pi over 2, which is going to be our answer choice A. Next, 17. If f of x equals e to the power of 2x ln x, what is the slope of the line tangent to the graph of f of x where x equals 1? So this is similar to our last problem in that we have a product of two functions, and we can just line this up like we did last time. Managed to draw this one a little neater. Okay, so what we have is the two factors. We have e to the power of 2x and the derivative of e to the power of 2x, which is going to be 2e to the 2x. And then for ln x, well, we have ln x, and our derivative of ln x is 1 over x. So our f prime of x is going to be e to the 2x times 1 over x. So we'll say e to the 2x over x. And then we're going to have plus ln x times 2e to the 2x. And now we can go plug in 1. F prime of 1 is equal to e to the 2, as in because 2 times 1 is 2, over 1. And then we have plus ln 1 2 e to the 2 times 1, so 2. Well, ln 1 is going to be simply 0, right? Because what power do you have to raise E2 to equal 1? It's going to be 0. So our answer is 0. So that zeroes out, and so we're simply left with e to the power of 2, which is answer choice C. Now we're going to get into our free response problem. The graph shown on the right is of the derivative of f. So that's going to be f prime of x. Determine where f is increasing and decreasing to justify your answer. And we can write out a number line for this. And to do that, where am I going to do that? I'll do it below here. Okay, this very much coincides with what we did earlier, right? We have the row F being plus, minus, increasing, decreasing, concave up, concave down. We have F prime being plus minus below here and increasing, decreasing. And then finally we have the F double prime. Not that it's asking that here. We have plus minus here. Well, yeah, it is gonna address concavity because we have C and D, concave up and concave down. So anyway, our critical numbers, F is decreasing and decreasing, justify your answer, are going to be where the F prime is 0. So here's F prime above here and F down below. And also negative 1. So we have negative 4, negative 1, and also 2. So we have above the x-axis here, right? So we have plus, we are increasing from negative infinity to negative 4. And we have another positive between negative 4 and negative 1, so we're increasing yet again. And then we are decreasing between negative 4 and 2, and we are increasing again for greater than 2. And so determine where f is increasing and decreasing, justify your answer. So we have increasing on where we have negative infinity to negative 4. And sometimes you don't have to separate these out. And also negative 4, negative 1, and negative 4, negative 1, and union this last piece 2 to comma infinity. Why? Because I'll put B slash C, F prime is greater than 0. And where's this thing decreasing? Decreasing on, we have negative 1 to 2. And why? Because x prime, or yeah, f prime of x is less than 0. Determine values where of x where f has a relative maximum, relative minimum. Well, we see one thing you can do with this analysis is you can kind of touch the curves here and see where they are. Okay, so I did with that red. So we can say relative max at x equals negative 1 because f prime changes from positive to negative, positive to negative. Okay, and then I don't have a lot of room over here, so I'm going to write to the right here. I'm going to make a little space, try to get my little, see if I can get my pen a little smaller size. That might be helpful to us here. Okay, so relative min at x equals 2 because if prime changes, not too legible there, from negative to positive. Okay, now I'm gonna create a concavity line up above here, and what we do here is we look at concavity is going to change where we change from plus to minus or minus to plus. You can see right here, I'm circling in red, the relationship between f prime and f double prime. You see that? So we're going to have, wherever f prime is increasing, we're concave up. Wherever f prime is decreasing, we're concave down. And so based on that, our critical numbers are going to be here, negative 4 also. Let me go ahead and put in negative 4. And also looks like negative 2.2. And we have down here, and it looks like it's 0.9. So we have, so we'll put down F double prime and F down below. To the left of negative 4, we're negative, so we're concave down between negative infinity and negative 4. Between 4 and negative 2.2, we're increasing. So that's going to be concave up over that interval. Between negative 2.2 and 0.9, we are decreasing, so we'll be concave down in that interval. And finally, 0.9 to infinity, we are increasing, so we have positive, so we're going to be concave up over this last interval. So we'll say concave up on, again we have intervals negative 4, negative 2.2, because b slash c, oops, so there's one more, I want to throw one more in there, don't I? We have u, where else were we concave up? 0.9 infinity because f, we can put f double prime, but we can, it's better to use the evidence we're getting from the graph, because f prime is increasing. Okay, and then comma, we say concave down. On, again we have two intervals, we have negative infinity to negative 4, union Where else we concave down? Negative 2.2, comma, 0.9. And that'd be because f prime is decreasing on that interval. And lastly, D, determine values of x where f has a point of inflection. Justify your answer. So there are points of inflection at x equals negative 4, and I'm just going to put set notation here, these little brackets, negative 4, and at negative 2.2, and then also at 0.9, and then I'll close with this little bracket here. And why? Because f prime changes from increasing to decreasing, or from decreasing to increasing. And if you want to justify in terms of what we determined, you could put because f double prime changes from plus to minus, or from minus to plus, or negative to positive. Anyway, that's it. I hope you had an opportunity to learn a lot from this. Good luck, and as always, thanks for viewing.